Hello and welcome to the Genomic Variant Analysis and Clinical Interpretation course. Till now we have learned about the literature-based attributes on the basis of ACMG-AMP guidelines to assign to sequence variants. Today we will be learning about various other attributes based on the ACMG-AMP guidelines that we assign to sequence variants. Now when a clinician sees a patient and suspects a genetic disorder by looking at the symptoms and the family history of the disease, then the sample of the patient is collected and the genome is sequenced. And after genome sequencing, the results are analyzed. Now, while analyzing the results, a lot of mutations are uncovered, but the task is to find the causal variant that, and then reporting a diagnosis to the patient. Now, finding the causal variant out of all the variants that are uncovered is like finding a needle in the haystack. So, to ease the process, we have to undergo various steps and annotate the variant based on few features, followed by interpreting the variant's effect on the basis of few guidelines. So ACMG-AMP gives few guidelines on the basis of the evidences that we collect from various online tools and databases and also literature search for the variant so that finally we can assign a clinical significance to the variant. Either benign, likely benign, uncertain significance, pathogenic, or likely pathogenic. So, till now we have learned that how on the basis of ACMG-AMP guidelines, we can assign the attribute based on the literature. Now, today we will be learning about how we can assign various attributes that could be fetched from various online tools and databases to assign pathogenicity or benign nature to a variant. So, first we will learn about how we can assign how we can use population data set to assign a very important parameter, that is the allele frequency, to a variant. Now, suppose in a group of 6 individuals, there is a variant which is present at a specific position in the gene in one of the individual in a heterozygous form. Now, how will we calculate the allele frequency for this variant? So, the allele frequency in this case would be the allele count by the total number of alleles. So, we can see here for the variant 1, that is G2C, the allele frequency is 1, that is out of the 12 alleles, it is present in only one allele, 1 by 12, that is 8%. Similarly, for the other two variants, we calculate the allele frequency using the same equation and we find that the frequency of the variant is varying. So similarly, in a healthy population data set, there are few variants which could be present in a very high frequency and there are few variants which could be present in a very low frequency. So the frequency of a variant is a very important factor in determining its potential pathogenicity, as the variants which are present commonly in the population are very less likely to cause a disorder. So, how do we assign or how do we assess the allele frequencies of a variant? To do so, we utilize the various population and subpopulation level data that is available on various online tools and resources like NOMAD, 1000 Genome Project, ESP6500, and many other more. Now, we will be learning that how we can use 3 of the databases like 1000 Genome, NOMAD, and ESP6500 to assign to calculate the allele frequency and further assign the attributes based on ACMG-AMP guidelines. Now, on the basis of a population data set and by looking at the frequency in race match control, which is often present in the literature, ACMG-AMP guideline says that if a variant is present in an allele frequency more than 5%, that is 0.05, then that is a very strong standalone criteria for benign interpretation of the variant. So in that case, we will assign BA1 attribute to the variant. On the other hand, if a variant is present in such a way that the allele frequency of the variant is greater than that for the disorder, then it is assigned a very strong criteria for benign interpretation, that is BS1. Now, since for rare Mendelian disorders, we are considering here the allele frequency to be between 1% to 5% as a criteria for BS1. Now, if a variant that we that is supposed to be causes for a disease which is fully penetrant at an early age and is recessive. So, if we find that variant in a very healthy adult individual, then we can say that this variant could be a benign. So, in that case, we will assign a strong benign criteria, that is BS2. Now, if a variant is present in a very low frequency of less than 0.05% in the population data sets, or if the variant is absent from the population data sets, then a moderate evidence of pathogenicity could be assigned to that variant, that is PM2. Now, let us take example of few such variants. So here we have collated a table with few examples. Now, how do we arrive at the, or how do we fetch the allele frequency of this variant from these databases? So one way is to either go to the databases individually and fetch out the allele frequency of the specific variant. Other is to use the variant annotator tool like VEP, which has already been explained in previous lectures. So herein we will be taking example of like three variants. So first I'll go to VEP, then I'll select the 30A7 version of the genome. So after selecting it, I'll be in putting my like in the input box the three variants. Now we'll see how we have to assign the we have to select few fields so that we can get those frequencies. Now first of all, we will select the RefSeq transcript, then we will also select the HGVS under the additional configurations identifier tab. Now, under the tab of variants and frequency data, we will select the 1000 genome global minor frequency and the ESP allele frequency. Now, here you can see here it is given that nomad exome allele frequencies. So, either we can select this nomad exome allele frequencies, or we can go to the predictions under the predictions tab in the DBNSF database. We can enable it, and then here we can see that we can also select the nomad genomes. So if we will see here in nomad genomes AC, nomad genomes AN and AF. So AC is the allele count, that is in how many individuals or in how many alleles that variant is present. Now how many total number of individuals are there in nomad or alleles in nomad, and this is the allele frequency. So we are interested in allele frequency, so we will select this here. And then we will also select the ancestral allele under the conservation heading, and then we can run it. So after performing the run, we will get the results. And so this is the table that we will get. Now here we can see in this table that we have got a title as AF. So this AF stands for the frequency of the variant in 1000 genomes population. And this AAAF stands for the frequency of the variant in African American population of ESP 6500 data set. And EAAF stands for the European American population in ESP 6500 data set. And at the last, we can see that we also have information from allele frequency information from nomad genomes. Now, for the ease, we are like I have just pasted this information here in the form of a table. And here you can see that for the variant one, the allele frequency out of all the four databases is highest in case of 1000 genome, which is 0.11, which is way more than the allele frequency 0.05, which is, so it is a standalone criteria for assigning benign interpretation to this variant. So we will assign BA1 in this case. Now, if you go to next variant, we observe that the highest allele frequency is observed in case of European American data set from ESP 6500. So in this case, we observe it to be between 1% to 5%, which is the criteria for assigning the BS1 attribute. So here we will assign BS1 to it. Now we can observe that in case of third variant, it is completely absent from all of the databases. So we will assign a moderate evidence of pathogenicity, that is PM2. to this variant. Now, after looking at the allele frequencies, there is another important attribute that we can assign using the predictions from computational methods. So there are various computational tools and prediction tools which say about a variant's pathogenicity based on several algorithms. So these algorithms predict the effect of the variant on the structure, function, or the sequence of the protein. So for example, SIFT, it is a database or it is a prediction tool which says about the effect of the variant based on the sequence conservation of the variant. Also, these tools vary in the type or in the type of the variant that they predict. So SIFT can predict for single nucleotide variants. Another tool is PolyFen, which you can see that it predicts on the basis of sequence conservation and also on the basis of the effect on the structure and function of the protein. And it can do this prediction for single nucleotide variants. Another database, that is CAT, it takes into account the machine learning, and it contrasts the fixed alleles in the nature with the simulated variants. So, and predicts and gives a C score to each of the variants. Now, CAT can also predict the pathogenicity for indels and stop gain in addition to the single nucleotide variants. Similarly, there is another tool named mutation tester, which can also predict on the basis of sequence conservation, structure, and function. And it also takes into account both indels and single nucleotide variants. So here we will be considering three databases, that is SIFT, PolyFen, and CAT. So for the SIFT, we see that the score range is from 0 to 1. And there is a cutoff of 0.05 that it has placed based on the algorithm. Now, if a variant lies between the 0 to 0.05 range, then it is predicted to be deleterious. And if a variant lies above 0.05 to 1, then it is predicted to be tolerated. Now, in case of PolyFen, it is completely opposite to say that if the score is 0, then that is a prediction for benign. And also it categorizes variant in three categories. So benign, probably damaging, and possibly damaging. So there is a cutoff of 0.453. So if a variant lies between the score of 0 to 0.453, then it is a benign variant. If the variant lies in between 0.453 to 0.9, then it is a probably damaging variant. And if it lies between 0.9 to 1, then it is a possibly damaging variant. Now, for the CAT, on the basis of its algorithm, provides a C score to all the variants. That C scores are then scaled up to give a FRET score to the variants. Now, for the variants which are having a FRET score of more than 15 or equal to 15, are recommended to be assigned as pathogenic by CAT. But this score threshold could be changed according to the requirement. Now, what are the attributes that we will assign on the basis of ACMG-AMP by using these computational predictions? So, ACMG-AMP guideline says that if most of the tools of computational prediction says that the variant is pathogenic, then we can assign a supporting evidence for pathogenicity to that variant. So here we have put a cutoff of that at least 2 out of 3 computational tools should say that a variant is deleterious or pathogenic. So here are the possible combinations if we look at these three databases to assign the PP3 criteria to a variant. Similarly, if we look at the benign nature, so in this case, if at least two out of the three databases say that the variant is benign, predict that the variant is benign, then we can assign a supporting evidence of benign interpretation, that is BP4, to the variant. Now, to take an example, here we have taken 4 variants. Now, how do we assess how do we calculate or how do we find out the score for these variants based on these tools? So either we can simply go to each of the database and utilize the tool to find out the score and the prediction, or we can use the variant annotator tool, that is VP, to understand and to fetch the information regarding the predictions. So we can see that we have pasted those four here. Now we have to select the RefSeq database. We have to click on the HGVS. Then under the prediction tab, we will see that the SIFT, it shows that the prediction and score. So if we require only prediction and only score, we can select from here, but we want both prediction and score in case of qualifying also. Now here is an option of CAD, which is by default not ticked off. So we have to tick it off, and then we have to tick off the ancestral allele, and then we can run it. Now after performing this run, we find that yes, so this is the in this table, this is the table. We can see in this table the SIFT, PolyFan and the CAD FRED scores are shown. Now for the ease, just copied, pasted it here in a table, and we can then observe here that in case of SIFT, we have learned that if the range is between 0 to 0, 0.05, then it is a deleterious variant. And here for the variant 1, we can see that the score is 0.1. So it is in the tolerated category, not deleterious. Similarly, for PolyFen, we can see that 0.08, so the variant lies in the benign category. So it will be benign according to PolyFen. But CAD predicts it predicts the score to be greater than 50, which says that it is pathogenic. But as per ACMG, two out of the three shows benign nature, we cannot take it as a supporting evidence for pathogenicity. We will assign BP4 to it. So similarly for the next variant, we see that SIFT says it to be deleterious, PolyFen says it to be benign, and CAD says it to be pathogenic. So since two out of three are saying that it is a deleterious variant, we can assign a supporting pathogenicity evidence, that is PP3. Similarly for the third variant, all the three databases predicted to be deleterious, so it will be PP3. Now for the next variant, we can see that since only the CAD score is given. So this is because this is a stop gain variant. So on the basis of the CAD score, we can assign PP3 to this variant. Now this is about the computational prediction based attributes. Now the next is, the variant is usually present in well annotated database, and those databases on the basis of their evidences predict the variant to be pathogenic or benign. So there are various such databases like ClinVar, HGMD, LOVD, which give us the clinical association of the variant with the disease. So herein we will be using ClinVar as the tool. So it is a freely accessible database of variations and the associated phenotypes, along with the evidences for the pathogenicity. So when you must have seen that when you enter a variant in ClinVar and you see the detailed explanation of that variant, you must have observed that on the top there is a tab which says interpretation to be pathogenic. So if the interpretation is pathogenic or likely pathogenic, then we can assign a supporting evidence for pathogenicity, that is PP5. If the variant is interpreted to be benign or likely benign by the ClinVar, then we can assign a supporting evidence for benign nature, that is BP6. Similarly, we can utilize other disease databases like LOVD, which is also a freely available database of curated DNA variants, or HGMD, which is also a database which contains all the literature variants which are and the disease causing nature of those variants. Now, till now we have seen that how a specific variant could be assigned few attributes based on the evidences for the variant. Now herein we will be talking that how a gene in which the variant is present might be affecting the pathogenicity or benign of nature of the variant. So we will look at the spectrum of the missense variants in a gene. So if you find a novel missense variant and in a gene, and you see that in that gene, that missense mutations are the most common cause of the disorder, means that most of the likely pathogenic and pathogenic mutations in that gene are missense mutations, then it is highly likely that the new novel missense mutation that you have identified is also pathogenic. So in that case, we will assign a supporting evidence of pathogenicity to the variant, that is PP2. On the other hand, if we observe that for a gene, most of the pathogenic and the likely pathogenic variants are those which are protein truncating. In that case, if we have to assign a new variant, if we find a novel missense variant, then we will assign a benign criteria to the variant, that is PP1. Now, how do we look at that? What is the common or what is the variant spectrum of the gene? Now, for this, we will again utilize the database, that is ClinVar. So here we can see that we have input a variant, which is a gene, which is ASPM. So you can see that on the left-hand side in the ClinVar, there are few filters which are shown. So if you will select the likely pathogenic and the pathogenic filter, we will see that there are a total of 221 likely pathogenic and pathogenic variants. Now, out of this, only 3 variants are shown to be missense. And we can see that how the frame shift nonsense and the splice site mutations are more in number. So we now know that for ASPM, most of the pathogenic and likely pathogenic variants known are protein truncating. So for this, if we find any novel missense change in ASPM, we will assign it PP1. Now, for the other gene, that is MFN2, we see that if we select the filter of likely pathogenic and pathogenic in ClinVar database, we can see that that out of the 138 variants, 76 are missense. That is more than 50% of the variants are missense. So in this case, if we find a novel missense change in MFN2 gene, we can clearly assign the criteria of PP2 to it. As per ACMG-MB guidelines, there are few attributes which could be assigned to a specific type of variant. So we know that from previous classes, we have learned that there are various types of variants like synonymous, non-synonymous, frame shift, non-frame shift, nonsense, and splicing, which could occur in a genome. Now, we can use various databases like RefSeq, which could help us to annotate the variant and determine the type of the variant. For example, if we give this variant as in the VCF format in the RefSeq database, we can annotate it on the basis of the gene name. We can understand its transcript details, the genomic location, and also we can look at the amino acid change that occurs due to this variant. Now, as per ACMG-AMP guideline, if a synonymous variant occurs in the genome that does not lead to any change in the protein amino acid sequence of the protein, then that is a supporting criteria for benign interpretation of the variant. And hence, an attribute of BP7 is directly assigned to those variants. Now, other class of variants is the protein truncating variant, wherein there could be different ways in which a protein is either truncated or not made at all. So in this case, the mutations could be highly pathogenic, and ACMG-AMP assigns a very strong criteria of pathogenicity to this variant, which is PBS1. But before assigning this criteria, there are few things to be kept in mind, like the variant should be protein truncating, and the loss of function should be a known mechanism for the gene. That is, we should already know through literature or various other tools that the protein truncating variant, that is the nonsense mutations in that gene, lead to the disease. And also, the variant should not be present in the last exon or the 50 base pairs of the second last exon. So this is because that it is possible that if a variant is present in the last exon, then The protein is already been made, which is fully functional or partially functional. Now, other category of variants is the non-frame shift indels or indels, which are the stop-loss variants. So, in this case, if a mutation occurs, then it does not lead to a change in the reading frame of the protein, but it could lead to addition or the deletion of few amino acids in this protein. So this is a moderate evidence of pathogenicity, and according to ACMG-AMP, we can assign 3M4 attribute to such variants. Now, consider there is an important consideration here. So to explain that, consider an example of a chapter in the Game of Thrones books, that is Hodor. Now, in the whole chapter, only the word Hodor is repeatedly mentioned. Now, if we add one or two pages, or even if one or two lines in this chapter, then it will not lead to a very drastic change in the storyline of the chapter. But if we add one or two bases or one or two lines in a chapter which contains unique story, then that could lead to a complete change in the storyline. Similarly, if the non-frame shift mutations, that is the addition of few amino acids, occurs in such repetitive regions of the genome, then in that case, it might not lead to such a drastic change in the protein function. So that could be a supporting criteria for benign nature of the variant. And BP3 attribute is given in such a case if the non-frame shift mutation is present in repeat regions. Now, how do we ascertain that where is the repeat region and whether our variant is present in the repeat region or not? So for this, we can utilize a resource that is a repeat masker. Either we can directly use that resource, or we can use UCSC, as it also provides a track for repeat masker. Now, if you go to UCSC and then under the tools option, if you select the genome browser, then we have to input our variant here in this format, which is given like this. So if we input our variant in this format, we'll get this as the output page, wherein you will see that the variant is mentioned at the top, the nucleotide sequence of the variation, and the gene name and all the other NMIDs are given below it. So we can see that there is a track of repeat master. So if you do not see this track, then you can just go down in the lower panel where there is a tab for repeats. Here you can see that there is an option for repeat master. You can just click on this drop down and select the effect, and then click on refresh to change the view of the this output page. Now you can see that this variant, there is nothing shown in this panel of repeat master. So this means that this variant is not present in the repeat element. So in this case, we will assign the PM4 attribute to this variant. Now, if we take example of another variant, which is this variant CTG in case of PolG, non-frame shift variant CTG in PolG, then you can see that repeat master shows a black line here. This means that this region has repeats. So in this case, we will assign the BP3 attribute to this variant. Now, the other category is the missense variant. For missense variant, suppose there is a change in a nucleotide G2C, which leads to a pathogenic change of valine at third position to leucine. Now you encounter a novel missense variant, which is the change from G to T, but leading to a same pathogenic change at the protein level, amino acid level, that is valine to leucine. Now, since we already know that the G to C change at this position leading to valine to leucine is pathogenic, then this new change, which is G to T, could also be pathogenic. And we can see here in the genetic code table that CTG, TTG, both code for leucine. Now, this is a very strong criteria for pathogenicity. So as per ACMG-AMP, we will assign the attribute of PS1 to such a variant. Now, if your variant of interest is at the same position, but the amino acid change in this case is different, you can see that it is valine 3-glutamate, and as GAG codes for glutamate. So in this case, we will assign a moderate evidence of pathogenicity as there is already a pathogenic variant known at the same position, but the amino acid change is different in this case. Now to see how we can ascertain this, that there is already a pathogenic change present at the protein of our interest, at the amino acid position of our interest, we will take example of this gene, and this is the protein change D222N. So we are interested in annotating this or interpreting this variant. So in this case, we will go to ClinVar, and we can simply search for this variant if it is present here. We can see that at 222 position, there is another variant, that is D222H, which is known to be pathogenic by ClinVar. So in this case, we can say that D222N will be assigned the attribute of PM5. Apart from these variant type based annotations, there are various other possible annotations which could be performed for a variant. Like we can check if the variant is present in the important functionally important domains of the protein, or whether the variant is present in a conserved sequence of the protein. Now consider a barbecue stick with few veggies on it, and just imagine that if you add some spices or remove some spices from the veggies, then that will affect the taste more as compared to adding those spices to simply on the stick. Similarly, there are few regions on the protein which are known as domains which perform a specific function for the protein. Now, if a mutation occurs in these domains, then it is a red flag, because it could majorly affect the protein function of the function of the protein. Whereas if the mutation occurs on the regions which are not functionally important domains, then that may or may not lead to a pathogenic effect. So if the variant is present in the functionally important domain, then it will be assigned a moderate evidence of pathogenicity, that is PM1. Now, how can we ascertain this fact that a variant is present in the important domain or not? So for that, we will look at example of a gene known FGFR3. So we can search for this gene in UniProt database, which is a database of all the proteins. So we can see here that if we take in this UniProt ID, we have to take in this UniProt ID for FGFR human, and we input it into the PFARM database, which is a database which help us to understand or to look at the protein's functional domains. Then we can see, if we input it here, then we will have this as the output, wherein we can clearly see that for this FGFR gene, there are these important domains which are marked, named as PFARM domains. So if you encounter a variation which has amino acid change in any of these domains, then that is a moderate evidence of pathogenicity, and we will assign the PM1 attribute to such variants. Okay. So now to summarize the database-based attributes, we can see that there are allele frequency-based predictions which we can fetch from various population data sets. There are region-based predictions, like if the variant is present in a functional domain or if the variant is present in a repeat region. There are various predictions which are given by computational tools, and on the basis of this, we can assign few criteria of pathogenicity or benign nature. And also there are few attributes by ACMG-AMP which are based on a specific variant type. So we have seen that if a variant is a protein truncating variant, then we can assign a very strong pathogenic criteria to that. Also, there are predictions which we can gather from disease databases, like already well annotated databases like ClinVar, HGMD, to assign few attributes to the variants. Now, till now, what we have done is we have collected few evidences, or we have collected few attributes by looking at the various online tools and databases. And also we have collected few attributes based on the literature search. Now, how can we combine these? Like, these are single pieces of evidences, just like a pieces of jigsaw puzzle. Now, how how to complete the puzzle and say that whether a variant is pathogenic or not. For that, we will we should have something in which we can just place these together and say, yes, this is a pathogenic variant. Place another set of evidences and say, yes, this is a certain significance variant, and similarly for benign. Now, ACMG AMP has laid down some rules based on these combining criteria and given some combining rules wherein we can say a variant to be pathogenic when either we have a previous one criteria along with any of these criteria, either you have two strong criteria, or you have one strong along with any of the moderate criteria. And similarly for likely pathogenic, uncertain significance, benign, and likely benign variants. Now this exercise we can perform manually, but there are various online tools also which help us in clinical interpretation of the variant after collecting the evidences. So one such tool is the tool of genetic variant interpretation by the University of Maryland. So this tool contains all the attributes that are given by ACMG AMP, and you can just select those attributes. For example, you have assigned something, some attributes of PS1, PS3, BP1, and suppose PP3 to a variant. Then it can give you a classification at the end that this variant is pathogenic. So in that way, you can classify this variant as pathogenic. So now we have learned that how we can gather the evidences from both the sources, databases, and literature, and how we can combine those to assign at a particular clinical significance of a variant, so that a particular proper diagnosis could be given to the patient. Now, today is a very special day, and that is the Rare Disease Day. And we hope and we believe that the understanding of the genomics would help us to make the change in the life of the people with rare diseases. So thank you all.